I mean, if you're not in control of your thoughts and actions, then why not just go with the flow? And this is what these studies seem to show. In fact, that pool ball has the same amount of control that we do. Assalamu alaikum YouTube, it's Imran here. Welcome to Foundational Thoughts. So today I'm going to be reviewing this book, Free Will by Sam Harris. It's been around for a while. It was published in 2012, but the reason for discussing it still actually is that the conversations that I have with atheists almost inevitably lead to this topic, and it's understandable why. The question of free will touches nearly everything we care about: morality, law, politics, religion. Most of what is distinctly human about our lives seems to depend upon our viewing one another as autonomous persons capable of free will. In fact, people feel that they are the authors of their thoughts and actions, and this is the only reason why there seems to be a problem of free will worth talking about. So free will is something that is almost ubiquitous within our experience, and which is why it comes up so often in conversation. Now, the way that I'm going to do this is I'm going to split this into three parts. So first, I'm going to just lay out the argument as I have understood it that Sam Harris presents from his book. And then I'm going to look at the types of evidence that he produces for this. And then the last thing is look at the consequences of the conclusion that Sam Harris comes to, both intended and unintended. But let's start with the end in mind. What I'm going to do is I'm going to give you the conclusion first so that you can hold this in your mind when we're trying to go through the arguments and the evidences and the consequences of the conclusion. Talking about free will, our experience of free will, on one hand, we can't make sense of it in scientific terms, and on the other hand, we feel that we are the authors of our own thoughts and actions. Sam goes on to say, thoughts and intentions simply arise in the mind. What else could they do? The truth about us is stranger than many suppose. The illusion of free will is itself an illusion. And what does this inevitably lead to? Am I free to change my mind? Of course not. It can only change me. Now that was the conclusion. I'd like to hold this in your mind as we go through the rest of the video. The argument appears to be that given materialism, i.e. that everything is ultimately physical, which is something that also science presupposes, given materialism, everything, including our thoughts, is part of and the result of a causal chain that goes back probably to the Big Bang or even earlier. That couldn't have been any other way, and therefore is completely determined. He seems to repeatedly emphasize that free will would be against any scientific materialist paradigm. Talking about free will, the fact that most of us feel that we freely author our own thoughts and actions, however difficult it may be to make sense of this in logical or scientific terms. The idea that we as conscious beings are deeply responsible for the character of our mental lives and subsequent behavior is simply impossible to map on to reality. Free will is actually more than an illusion or less, in that it cannot be made conceptually coherent. Here we see Sam Harris reiterating the incoherence of a concept of free will with the scientific materialist paradigm, and therefore Sam Harris is unable to map this onto reality or make it conceptually coherent or make it logically or scientifically valid. And Sam Harris gives examples of this when he talks about criminal behavior. If I were to trade places with one of these men, atom for atom, I would be him. There is no extra part of me that could decide to see the world differently or to resist the impulse to victimize other people. If I had his genes and life experience and an identical brain or soul in an identical state, I would do exactly as he did. There is simply no intellectually respectable position from which to deny this. So here we see just a re-emphasis of the materialist paradigm that Sam Harris puts forward. And obviously for him, that is the only respectable position. Before you point out that Sam Harris doesn't assert materialism, essentially my view is that he does this so that he can point to the soul and say, well, actually you didn't choose this either and you have no control over this. Your soul could be a psychopathic soul. Sam Harris bolsters his argument by asserting that we lack any control over the causal chain, and therefore we lack free will because the causal chain causes the outcome. Now this is reminiscent of an argument from Lucretius, who was an Epicurean poet. The past controls the present and the future. You can't control the past. You can't control the way the past controls the present and the future, so you can't control the present and the future. He asserts that the reason you lack free will is that you didn't choose any of the prior causes, be that a soul or your parents or your time and place of birth or your gender or your life experiences or your genome or the development of your brain. And now your brain is simply making choices on the basis of preferences and beliefs that were hammered into it over a lifetime. Consider what it would take to actually have free will. You would need to be aware of all the factors that determine your thoughts and actions, and you would need to have complete control over those factors. And the reasoning seems to be that if you weren't in control of everything, then you can't be in control of anything, because that's all controlled by the prior everything. The issue with this line of reasoning is that Sam Harris seems to argue against a position that no free will advocate would actually claim. Unless, of course, he knows someone who claims that the reason that they have free will is because they choose their soul, their parents, their time and place of birth, their gender, their life experiences, their genetics, or brain development. So let's look at some of the evidences. Sam Harris gives examples of people who had brain tumours that led them to do criminal behaviour. And when this tumour is removed, their behaviour returns to normal. And this leads to the suggestion that the moral responsibility from that individual for their actions is removed because the tumour was such that it did not allow them to have any control. Now this seems quite reasonable. He then seems to suggest that we are all affected by biology in some sense or other, and we have some sort of aberration or other that leads to our particular types of thoughts and that leads to our particular types of actions. And if we knew the state of an individual's brain at any one point, we would not hold them morally responsible for what they do. However, this leads to a bit of a slippery slope. This develops into considering everything that anyone may do in the light of bad genes, bad parents, bad environment, and bad ideas, as these are uncontrolled factors that they must mitigate for crimes, and they must remove moral responsibility, at least to some degree. The issue here is that this is pretty much a moot point. We've already dismissed the idea that we are free to think or that we are free to make choices, because both of these are the results of a uncontrolled causal chain. Positing other things within the chain that we also don't have any control over doesn't really add to the argument in any way. Surely moral responsibility has already been removed, which is going to be a problem later. The second type of evidence that Sam Harris puts forward is a thought experiment. You're required to think of an arbitrary thing and to make an arbitrary choice. And then you're required also in that process to deliberate upon the howness of this. How do you come to your choice? And this is supposed to appear to you as a mysterious process. And because it is mysterious, therefore you have no control. So you must somehow not be able to decide what you think. If you pay attention to your inner life, you will see that the emergence of choices, efforts, and intentions is a fundamentally mysterious process. You cannot know why you were finally able to adhere. A moment or two of serious self-scrutiny, you might observe that you no more decide the next thought you think than the next thought I write. Now, there is an issue with this for me in that even in deciding to do the thought experiment, I was making a decision. And when I was choosing between whichever factors that I wanted to consider and then deliberate upon and make a choice upon, I was actively making choices. This is how I was experiencing it. Now, there is a counterexample to this, and the counterexample might be me making this video. So me making this video required me to hold certain things in my mind so that I could focus my train of thought on the task at hand. At the same time, I was holding back thoughts that were also on my mind that I want to consider later. Now, because I was able to control my thoughts and focus my mind on this train of thought, then I have direct experiential evidence of controlling my train of thought and choosing. The fact that a person may not know how their thoughts originated is irrelevant to the fact that I am able to use them and to control them to carry out the tasks that I have at hand. This is the same as somebody not knowing how the combustion engine works, but still utilizing a car to take them from A to B. The third type of evidence that Sam Harris puts forward is neuroscientific studies. He quotes the 1983 study from Benjamin Libet, in which people were asked to make the decision to move and then make a note of the time when they had decided to move. And at the same time, their neural activity in terms of electrical activity was being monitored. What they found was there was some electrical activity that preceded the decision to move before the subjects were aware that they had made the decision to move. The other example was the 2011 study by Freed, and that suggested that up to 700 milliseconds before a person was aware that they were going to make the decision to make a voluntary movement, there was some electrical activity that be correlated to that decision. This was accurate about 80% of the time. Now, after reading some of these studies, I think it would be really a useful thing to do a separate video where I go through the neuroscientific studies individually and see how they stack up in terms of providing evidence that Sam Harris suggests they do. But let me just leave you with a thought on these for now. And the thought is the difference between correlation and causation. So a correlation is a statistical measure, and it's really a measure to see a linear relationship between two separate variables. As one variable goes up, the other one is related in some way, whether it goes up or goes down, but there is a relationship between them. Causation is slightly different. Causation is that you cannot have one thing without the other thing. The first variable is the reason for bringing the second variable into existence, and the second variable can fluctuate because of the first variable. Now that's causation. So what do we see in this study? So if P is neuroelectrical activity and Q is awareness of the decision to move, P occurs before Q about 80% of the time. But Q can also occur without P about 20% of the time. So what we know from this is because Q can occur without P, P doesn't cause Q, nor does Q cause P. At best, there is a correlation between P and Q, but that's really all you can say about this. So the idea that somehow this evidence establishes that the electrical activity brings about our conscious thought or decisions is lacking. So now I wanted to get onto some of the consequences of the conclusion that Sam's come to, that we don't have free will. And Sam also cites a couple of studies in this regard. So the first is a 2008 study by Voss and Schuler. And in this study, subjects were given reading material. One set of people were given reading material that encouraged the belief in determinism, that you do not have a free will. And the other group were given material that discouraged the belief in determinism, i.e. that you do have a free will. And then they were given a test in which there was the possibility of cheating. And the findings were that those that were encouraged to disbelieve in free will cheated significantly more than the free will group. The second was a 2009 study by Baumeister, which showed that a lack of belief in free will is associated with two things essentially. One is a reduced willingness to help people. And the other thing that was noted is that it made people act more aggressively than they would otherwise. So we can see that our sense of agency makes us control some of our more base desires. And we are less willing to do this if we don't think we are in control of our thoughts and actions. I mean, if you're not in control of your thoughts and actions, then why not just go with the flow? And this is what these studies seem to show. Now, Sam Harris responds to these studies by saying, well, it didn't make me a bad person, which is not really an argument or an evidence. The other thing that actually is impacted by this perspective is the idea of morality. Sam Harris seems to suggest what we condemn most in another person is a conscious intention to do harm. Now, this doesn't really make sense when I think about it, because what has Sam Harris already said? Actions, intentions, beliefs, and desires can exist only in a system that is significantly constrained by patterns of behavior and the laws of stimulus and response. Choices, efforts, intentions, and reasoning influence our behavior, but they are themselves part of a chain of causes that precede conscious awareness over which we exert no ultimate control. He states his choices matter, but I do not choose what I choose. The choice was made for me by events in my brain that I, as a conscious witness of my thoughts and actions, do not inspect or influence. So on one hand, Sam Harris is saying that we are concerned about someone's conscious intention to do harm and holds them morally responsible because of that. And on the other hand, he's suggesting that even this conscious intention is just simply something that we witness and we have no control over. So therefore, you cannot reconcile the idea of not being in control with then having moral culpability. And this is one of the problems with this whole idea. How could you hold anyone responsible for anything if they had no control over what they were doing? So the interesting question here was, what should we do with this consciousness that we have and these thoughts and these actions that come that we have no control over? Getting behind our conscious thoughts and feelings can allow us to steer a more intelligent course through our lives while knowing, of course, that we are ultimately being steered. And this just seemed to suggest that you're consciously aware of being in a car that's driving along the road. You are in the driver's seat, but there's no steering wheel and the car is taking its own direction. And the most intelligent thing you can do is just go in the same direction that the car is taking you. So in this paradigm, you're essentially a pool ball that's bouncing around, striking the cushions and striking other balls and going wherever the breakoff shot has led you. In fact, that pool ball has the same amount of control that we do. Now, one of the more fundamental problems that I had with this concept is that it does away with rationality and it does away with truth. Let me explain. If your very thoughts are the product of a causal chain over which you have no control and is completely determined, then there is no other thought that you could have thought. So your thought process and then your related rationalizations are also part of this causal chain over which you have no control. Your rationalizations then are not really anything that you have any control over. They're just happenstance. They're just accidents. They were just going to be. We can pursue any line of thought that we want, but our choice is the product of prior events that we did not bring into being. Now, if rationality goes out of the window because of this concept, then anything that you can apply rationality to would also go out of the window because of this concept. So be that science or more fundamentally, any search for truth. Now, in the light of this, I want you to think about the irony of ironies. Imagine choosing to write a book about the lack of free will in a world where free will doesn't exist. Talking about his choice to write free will, he says that the next choice you will make will come out of the darkness of prior causes that you, the conscious witness of your experience, did not bring into being. So Sam Harris had no choice but to think that free will doesn't exist. This wasn't based upon any thoughts that he had any control over. It didn't involve any rational thinking process, and nor does it correlate with any reality or truth. It was not a choice. From the moment the Big Bang occurred, this book was inevitable. So the question is, are you really a complex mechanism that thinks it's free but actually isn't, like some sort of sophisticated robot? Can you think? Are you free to think? Or are you simply being buffeted by the winds of the causal chain of events that led to where you are? I'll leave that choice with you, or not. Those were my thoughts on this book. Please leave me your feedback in the comments below. If you found this video or any other video on this channel beneficial, please share with others so they may also benefit. Assalamu alaikum YouTube.